Hello, this is the Silver Watchman. And welcome back to Vector Man. This is an episode 3 of a possibly 4-part series. Episode 4 of a originally 4-part series. It is going to be going past the 4 parts. Unbeknownst to me, well, very, very much known. Because this level took a lot longer than I expected it to. So, let us continue where we left off. Now, in a previous episode, we were pretty much defining the fool. But in this episode, we shall learn how to avoid being a foolish person. We're going to be looking at Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7, King James Version of the Bible. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Now, we're going to be breaking that down. What does that mean? Well, I'm seeing a few different meanings to this. One of which is that fools have a tendency to refuse instruction. And anybody that appears to know more than them. Which does tell me something. They don't like to be wrong, ever. But in my time, I've quite learned that more often than not, I'm often wrong. And I always have to double check to make sure that I'm actually right about certain things. Things that require opinions can be fairly easy to be right about because there's no right or wrong answer, it's just an opinion. Like, hey, do you like this food? Yes, I like the food. Please pass me some more. You know, something like that. And, you know, when somebody tells me that I'm wrong, I'm normally pretty willing to listen because I am always under the assumption that I have messed something up somewhere. I just don't often know where I made a mistake, so when I see the mistake, I'm like, oh good, a mistake. But where? And that's why it's always good to have more than one opinion on something. It's okay to be told that you're wrong. It's okay to be wrong. But what does that mean, the fear of the Lord? Now, does that mean you're sitting there quaking in your boots at every single thought of God? In some cases, yes. But in most cases, no. To my understanding, the fear of the Lord is another way of saying respect. When you fear someone, you respect them. Think of it like this. Would you be afraid of a of lightning? Is anybody ever really afraid of lightning all the time, 100% of the time? Or only when it's striking does it make you go, oh, that was loud. And then you go about your day. Similarly applies to the fear of the Lord. With the fear of the Lord, you have a healthy respect of the power of God. Instead of saying, wow, that was loud, it's more along the lines of, whoa, that was awesome. Because, I mean, to see God in action, like, right before your eyes, is amazing. There's not a word that I have to describe it that's any closer than amazing. It's just simply, like, the just seeing it, seeing the will of God unfold right before you is fantastic. It's amazing. It's I don't have a word for it. I wish I did. I really wish I did have a word for it. So you have this kind of healthy respect of God and what he's capable of, which is everything. You want something really cool to happen at like 2:30 p.m. the next day? God can make it happen. But it's also up to his will, because keep in mind, God is sentient as well. He's not this, you know, all-powerful being that has no thoughts. No, he's sentient, and he's going to weigh in like the factors of like, okay, is this gonna make it dangerous for somebody else? And, you know, so on and so forth, which is why a lot of people say God never answers their prayers, but at the same time, God is also keeping in mind everybody else's prayers as well. So let's say you have two farmers. One farmer prays for rain, and another farmer prays for drought. Now, those two farmers are conflicting each other, but the reason that one farmer is praying for a drought is so he can weed out a infestation of rats or whatever. I don't know, something. I don't know why somebody would pray for drought. Now, God is keeping in mind that those rats are very dangerous to that farmer's family because they carry a particular disease that has no cure, because it's a new one, and it is bad. And he wants those rats to basically, he wants those rats to die of thirst. And they're not gonna die of thirst if there's rain. So that's why that farmer is praying for a drought. But another farmer is praying for rain because he needs to harvest his crops so he can feed not only his family, but the rest of the community. So God will keep in mind those two prayers. Now, what man one wants is just to be rid of the rats, but he's not really praying for that. His prayer is a little bit more selfish than the other one. That's praying for his crop, for rain, for his crops, because he wants to be able to feed his family, as, you know, any man should. Any respectable man should be more than willing to provide for his family. And any man that isn't willing to is not a man in my book. But that's just my opinion. So, also, I'm gonna go on a side note here. This is the doofiest looking robot fish I've ever seen. And now he's gone. But back to the other thing. So, is God gonna answer man one's prayer or man two's prayer? Well, that's part of the reason why we have the Holy Spirit, and what makes the Holy Spirit so fantastic. The Holy Spirit, when we pray one thing, the Holy Spirit will pray what we actually want to pray, but we don't have the words or the understanding for it. Meaning that it'll speak on behalf of us. And whoops. It'll speak on behalf of us and say what we really want to happen, and that's what God's going to work on. Because we may say we want something, but we say it out of a lack of understanding. A solution that we think we would be able to handle. Yeah, so a solution that we think that we want, but in reality, we want a solution for the problem that's really there, the core problem. And that's normally what the Holy Spirit will pray for while we are praying. So what God's going to do is this. God is going to communicate with his Holy Spirit while the man that's praying for a drought. Because a man that's praying for a drought is just looking for a solution to his problem. But he's not thinking about the effect that that drought would have on the entire community. If they are reliant on these crops to get through the winter. So, keeping that in mind, when man 2 prays for rain, there's a higher chance of God answering that prayer than the original prayer of, give me a drought. God already knows why you're doing what you're doing. But he also wants you to say it and to, in a way, explain yourself. And say why you want it. It's not that God doesn't understand why you want something. God wants to be sure that you understand why you want something. But if you don't even understand why you want it, and you want it, God isn't really gonna give it to you. You're saying, I need it because I need it. Is not a proper reason, but saying, for example, man 2 knows exactly why he's praying for rain. He's praying for rain because he knows that he needs that food for his family so that way they can get through the winter, because he loves his wife and he loves his kids. But he also knows that with the rain, he'll have a surplus as well that'll help out the other people that weren't having that good of a harvest this particular year, which does happen. And every now and again, God will give one person that is of him a little bit more resources than people of him. And that is not so that way they can run off with it and do whatever they want. That's actually so that way they can spread those resources around and share with the others. With other people that need it. Huh. Okay then. Yeah, and so God's gonna end up answering man number 2's prayer because he knows why he's praying for this. He knows that he's praying for it so he can help out his community. And so, he can make sure his family survives the winter. Now, God also knows man A and man B's heart as well. So let's say if man B is on the flip side, is praying for a drought because he knows that these rats, if they survive, they'll spread around and they will give everyone a disease that they don't have a cure for. which is pretty much the 1800s in a nutshell, but oh well. So, if he's praying for that and keeping in mind the community instead of his own benefit, gotta be more likely to answer his prayer. Especially if the other man just wants it to rain so we can have extra crops so he doesn't have to do as much work next season. Now the roles are flipped, meaning that the man that's praying for a drought might actually get his prayer before the man that's praying for rain. But such is the knowledge of God in a way. Like, God can weigh all of that in. Like, he weighs all of that in, and that's just a small amount of factors that I listed, which I'll admit, to me at least, seems like a lot of factors. But God's weighing that in, but he's also weighing in the needs and wants of everyone else as well. As well as, how is this going to impact the environment? How is this going to impact the crops in actuality? How is this going to impact sales of like certain things and affect the livelihood of other people? As well as like, how is this going to affect their hearts? How is this going to affect their souls? Everything. Just everything. Like, so many factors that I personally cannot list them all. Mostly because, one, I'm almost out of time for this episode. And two, not a lot of things come to my mind. But a lot more come to God's. So, yes. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but this fear is more of a healthy respect of God and his power and his ability to perform, his ability to be there, his ability to answer. I'm going to save right here because if I die again. Whoops. I did not mean to save there. Alright, now the game, for the rest of the game, it's gonna be high stakes. That is nice. But yeah, this fear of the Lord is more of a respect for God and his power. And understanding that he is far more capable than you to handle most, if not all, situations. And I understand trusting in the Lord is a bit, it's difficult, okay? It's not going to be the easiest thing on the planet. In fact, it's one of the hardest things to do because God is God. And understanding that God doesn't need any help, at least for me, is a very hard concept, because everybody needs help. Every single person needs help. But the fact that God doesn't need any help, initially for me, was one of the hardest things about serving God, is that, like, I have a savior, I have a creator that doesn't actually need me around. So why am I around? And I would often ask God that in the beginning. What is my purpose? Like, why am I needed? And you know what that answer was? You're here because I want you to be here. And if you need a purpose, then let that purpose be serving me. Now, to anyone who's not saved, that sounds like a very, like, what? Kind of response. But somebody that has a relationship with Jesus Christ knows that when God says that, he doesn't say that in a bad or selfish manner. He says it in a kind of, like, because God doesn't think like us. Like, for us, in our mindset, the human, it's like, what? No, I live for you? And that's how most humans would react, at least nowadays. But in reality, that's... That's kind of not the case. God says that in a way of kind of like ease you. Because, like, let's face it, when we have a lot of things to do, we have a lot of things to say, a lot of things to know, a lot of things to understand. It gets very complicated very fast, and it becomes overwhelming. And it becomes easy to be overwhelmed with all the decisions that we have in our day-to-day lives. And yet, God just keeps it simple and just says, don't worry about any of that. I've got that. For now, just focus on me. Let that be your purpose. And walk. So God keeps it simple. Because, you know, all we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Isaiah 53:6, King James Version of the Bible. And that him is Jesus. God laid the sins of every single man on his own son, so that way we could live forever. Now join me in prayer. If you want to have a relationship with Jesus, with the Lord. Let us begin. Repeat after me. Dear Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. I believe that you can save my soul. So please, may you forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my iniquity. And wash away my sins with your blood. Please. Wash me clean. And fill me with your Holy Spirit. I thank you for doing so. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 6. Sorry, my speech impediment is kind of coming through because I'm a little bit tired today. It has been a very long week, but this moment right here, these episodes are, honestly, they're the highlight of my week. They are very, in my eyes, they're very good. Very nice and very, very good. And it makes me happy to serve the one true God. And I'm grateful. But if you'd made that prayer in faith, and you didn't make the same mistake I did while praying, which honestly does happen every now and then, because I get a lot on my mind a lot of the time. I mean, there's this, there's the job I do full-time, there's college, there's all of you guys. Then there's a state of the world affairs, which, honestly, and then there's a little task that God had. Had given to me, and it's, for now it's just between me and God, but it's quite a big task, and sometimes thinking about it leaves me a little bit overwhelmed. And it's crazy to think about, but at the same time, it's pretty cool, because I'm not worthy of this honor, this joy that I have. In my eyes, it's a gift. It's 100% a gift from God. And I'm grateful. God is good. God has been very good to me. And I am grateful. But yeah, if you made that prayer in faith, then your natural next step is to go and receive the baptism of the water. And that's basically a confession before man, God, demon, and angel that Jesus Christ is the Lord and Jesus Christ is God. that he's not only the Son of God, but that he's God incarnate. Born through a virgin, lived for 33 years, only to be effectively beaten to death and hung on a cross, just to come back 3 days later and give us hope for eternal salvation. That's the Jesus I serve. That's my best friend, Jesus Christ. And even though people may say his name in vain, when I call him, I'm calling my best friend. I wait that day I can go home. And every time I think about it, a tear comes through my eye. That I'm here. On this world. A strange and alien planet. When I could be up there. In peace. In joy and in love. But for now, I shall carry the peace of the Lord with me. But if you want to support my channel, you could either subscribe, share, or like the video. Or you could just go to my merch shop. That's simple. Just go to my About section, click the link, which is Silver Watchman's Wares, and it'll lead you to my shop. Right now, I don't have a variety, like that big of a variety. I just have a couple of different things and a whole bunch of different colors, but that's about it. I'm going to try to come out with a bigger variety later on when I have the time, which isn't right now. Other than that, though, thank you all for watching. Glory be to God. Blessings upon every single one of you, even to those of you that hate me. But this is the Silver Watchman. This is the Silver Watchman signing out.